guys, welcome back to the Van Murray Podcast. It's been a while, almost over a year to be exact. If you've listened to the first two episodes of this season, then you'll know that I love to travel and I was building out a van to live in for quite some time. Well, guess what? She's done! And I've been living out of my van for 6 months now, off and on, and I absolutely love it. I am currently right outside of Joshua Tree, if you can tell for my video watchers, and I am really enjoying SoCal right now, and so I hope that you're also in a place that you really enjoy. For the people who are watching, you may be wondering what the heck is going on over here. Well, for my audio listeners, I don't have my lav mics with me in the van, and so I have a fun little contraption made out of a pair of Apple headphones and a scrap piece of copper metal attached to my cabinets here. And that's what I'm using as my mic in order to get somewhat good audio. So, I don't know what you expected from me, but this is pretty on brand. So, anyways, my hope is to finish out season one with some of my most famous travel stories from the past, and then maybe we'll come back for season two and I can update you on how life has been on the road thus far and give you some recent travel stories. So I hope you're doing well wherever you are, and this week I'm going to share with you the story of how I felt like I was almost a missing person, and it's an interesting one, so strap in and let's get into it. So this story starts maybe in October of 2021 when I took my first ever trip in the van. I took a solo road trip up to Nashville, volunteered for a music festival, and I honestly had a blast. This is my first time that I went to Nashville, and some of you may remember my little mini Dating My Way Through Nashville series. Maybe I can make a podcast episode about that someday because it was honestly sort of hilarious. So, anyways, I took my trip up to Nashville and had a blast. Met a handful of lovely people while I was there, but on my way back, I decided to stop up and camp outside of a national forest in northern Alabama, if I'm not mistaken. And this is where things got a little crazy. So, just for context, anytime I get myself into what I would consider a compromising situation, it's always a combination of tiny little decisions until it's too late and you can't do anything about it. Also, this situation was totally preventable. Now, in my current living situation in the van, I have lots of safety precautions that I have put in place, and hopefully I will never have to use them, but they are a game changer and truly help prevent situations like this one. So, I didn't have a lot of those things yet in the van when I took this mini trial trip to Nashville, so unfortunately, the worst did happen. So my plan was to drive into this national forest. I had found a dispersed camping site that I had done research on, and I was pulling up there in the afternoon of a weekday, I'm pretty sure. And I am traveling down this little dirt road after getting off the main road, and I noticed that my service cut out maybe 2 miles, 1.5 miles from my destination. And I was paying attention to this because having service or not having service is honestly the difference between being in a safe and an unsafe situation. So I was definitely paying attention to that and making note of it. I go down the dirt road and I miss one of my turns, and so I decide I'm going to turn around in this dirt road, and instead of taking like a 15-point turn, I was being a little lazy, tried to cut it close, and ultimately I got my van stuck on the side of this dirt road because I was trying to make a turn and ended up getting my front driver's side tire stuck in like the stuck in, it wasn't a ditch, but a large divot on the side of this dirt road, which is very common in national forests, to collect rainwater so that the road itself does not get washed out when it rains, and they have to maintenance the roads less. So anyways, I hop out of the van and decide to start going down my list of ideas to get my van unstuck. In this moment, I wasn't really worried and I wasn't really scared. I was fully convinced that I could get my van unstuck. So I started going down said list, the first of which was to use my floor mats in my van. That didn't work. I decided to use Crazy Creek, which if you know me, you know I absolutely love my Crazy Creeks. They have so much versatility. Well, one of them was ripped to shreds trying to get my van unstuck, so had to throw that one away. I decided to take a scrap piece of wood that I had in the van and tie it to the tire so that every single time the tire went around in rotation, the piece of wood would, hopefully the idea was to give me traction. That didn't work because the strings I used to tie said wood popped. I obviously tried just getting it out without using anything. That didn't work. I tried digging my tires out. That didn't work. And it was in this moment when I had reached the bottom of my list that things started to settle in and I started to get a little worried because I'm a very scrappy person, and along my travels and even in my life, I often do not get to the bottom of the list of my ideas to help solve a problem. And I had made it to the bottom of my list, which meant I needed help from another human being, and I didn't really know how I was going to do that. So I decided to start preparing to leave the van in search of help. This was probably around 3 or 4 p.m. at this time. I like to show up to my campsites early and in the daylight. Honestly, for this particular situation and situations like it, you never know what you're walking into, no matter how much research you do, and daylight drastically changes how safe a situation feels as one person and as a female. So I started to get ready. I packed myself an extra layer of flannel, put on a pair of tennis shoes. I packed my fanny pack with my phone and a headlamp, anticipating that it might get dark before I make it back. That definitely scared me, but it was a reality. So unfortunately, I'd been using my phone the majority of that day, so it was already around 50% when I decided to head out on this journey. Now, already in this story, my current situation now, and the safety precautions that I have in place, I hopefully would never be in this situation again. For one, I have invested in some Max Tracks to help get my van unstuck anywhere I might need. I luckily have only had to use them once. Actually, I didn't even have to use them. I took them out, but someone ended up helping me. Two, I now have a satellite phone, so if I happen to be out of service, I could potentially use that to ask for help. Three, I'm pretty diligent about charging my phone and have battery packs to prevent me from having my only lifeline die. So, already I have lots of precautions in place to prevent a situation like this from ever happening again, but alas, this is where I was, and this is how I learned. Even though I knew all those things and had plans to do all those things at the time, I just hadn't gotten that far in my van life preparation yet. So, yeah. man, do I wish I had them at the time. Anyways, I got myself prepped and ready, locked the van, and actually wrote a note to leave on my dash just in case someone happened to go down the dirt road and see my van stuck on said dirt road, almost in the middle of it. And the note read something like, date and time, got my van stuck, went in search for service, started walking up dirt road 9758, Western direction. I just made that up, but you get the gist. If you find my van before me, come looking for me, basically. I don't know if I still have that note or a photo of it, but it was pretty eerie writing that down, because in my brain, I'm prepping for worst case scenario, because at that point I felt like a sitting duck, and I felt stuck, and that I didn't have like any resources in this time to help me get out of that. So I began the walk down the dirt road to the main road in hopes that I could catch service at some point when, at some point while walking. I'm pretty sure I took a video of myself just in case someone found my phone before they found my body. So there would be a timestamp, and so that they could hopefully find me. Which is also a very eerie feeling. Never happened to me before. I literally tried absolutely everything to get my van unstuck. I'm alone with no service. I'm on 600G heading towards 280 something. It's about 2 miles, 1.5 to 2 miles. I don't know what I'm doing. I could get the van out if I had another person's help, and it was my fault. I was being lazy and I didn't want to turn around and I didn't see the dip in the road. I'm pissed. And I'm kind of sketched out, I'm not gonna lie, because this is like the beginning of a missing person case. What the fuck am I doing? I don't know what to do. I don't say that often. I really hope I'm never in a situation like that ever again. Some may say that it wasn't that serious, but as a woman who exists in the world, I'm sure you could ask any woman and that's instantly where their brains go. So yeah, that's what happened. I remember walking down that dirt road and the tiny little clinks of the zippers on my fanny pack. It made it sound like there was someone who was following me, and it was freaking me out. And so every now and again I would stop on the dirt road, hold, like, it was just the loudest sound ever, and I think that just speaks volumes to where I was mentally, which was scared. And that is not my default. If you know me, you know that it takes a lot for me to get to a place where I feel stuck and scared. So I began my walk down this dirt road, and once I got there where I thought I should have service, I made it to the main paved road, and there wasn't any service. And it was in that moment that I freaked out, and I just started crying in the middle of this country road in a national forest that was paved, and really thought to myself, how the hell am I going to get myself out of the situation? So after I had my little moment, calmed myself down, and I decided to pick a direction on said paved road and continue my walk in hopes that I would find service. So I started to do that. And maybe about another half of a mile up the road, I got one bar and literally like freaked out in relief and began my search for what was around me, if there was a ranger station phone number I could call. But my service was very, very slow, and it would go in and out and in and out. And so at this time, I started to get really, really worried, and I was on the top of like this sort of hill on the side of the road, and there was those guardrails on the hill because it was an elevated surface. And this was like, I mean, I'm sure the speed limit was like 40 miles an hour, if that, on this road. Like, and there was barely any cars passing, and it's in this moment where you start to question, am I in real danger or am I not? is this an emergency or is it not? Am I being wasteful of resources if I call 911 right now? Do I stick my thumb out and have myself be at the mercy of a stranger who I don't know? That seemed really scary to me. So I'm pretty sure I decided to see if I could send a text to my best friend at the time, because I needed someone to know where I was, and I honestly didn't want to reach out to my parents because I didn't want to scare them and freak them out, and they've actually never heard this story. So, sorry Mom and Dad if you're watching, this is the first time you're hearing this story. I've learned from this situation, and do not do the same things now. My life looks a lot less chaotic and a lot more safe. Also, if you're considering sending this to my parents, maybe don't. I don't think they need that extra stress in their life. But, you know, do what you want, I guess. Anyways, also, if you're a part of my family, I love you, and I swear I'm safe. Anyways, I texted my best friend, and I was like, hey, I got my van stuck. This is exactly where the van is. This is exactly where I am. Currently trying to find help. Like, this isn't an emergency. I just need someone to know where I am. And she was like, oh, okay. And she was also very concerned and was ready to call anyone in my area to help me. But I said, no, like, you know, let me figure this out. And so I think maybe one or two cars passed me, and I didn't, like, put my thumb out or ask for help or anything. And then at one point I was like, I don't know what I'm doing right now. My service isn't working well enough for me to find a number to call or do anything. I'm gonna stick my thumb out. And I'm pretty sure that's also why I sent a text to my best friend, because my service wasn't working well enough for me to find a number to call. I couldn't, like, make any calls, or barely could make any calls, but I could send text messages for whatever reason, so that's why I sent her a text, so that maybe she could find a number for me to call, or call a number for me, or something. I was just trying to figure out the situation. And I remember at one point, I stuck out my thumb, and there was this little tiny car that drove past on the other side of the road, and she decided to stop, and she was another female. And you could tell she was a bit reluctant to stop, and when she did, she rolled down her window and she said, hey, are you okay? And I was like, hey, like, I'm so sorry to bother you. Like, thank you so much for stopping. I don't normally do this. And I, like, tried to walk a little bit closer to her so I didn't have to yell. And every time I took a step, she moved her car forward, because she wanted to maintain distance from me. And I honestly totally understand that. As another female, like, you want to help, but you never know what you're getting yourself into, so I totally respected it. And after I realized, like, how uneasy I made her feel, you know, I kept my distance, and I just yelled, and I said, hey, like, I got my car stuck up the road, and I don't have any service, and I'm alone, and I'm just trying to figure out what to do, and I was like, are you going, you know, east? And she was like, yeah. And I was like, isn't there a state park, you know, up west? And she was like, yeah. And I was like, do you think that there would be a ranger who would be able to help me? And she said, possibly. And I was like, can you help me? Like, I don't know what to do. Like, I'm trying to get up there, but there's no way I can walk, because, I mean, it was like 5 miles. And at this point, it's like, four, maybe 5 p.m. And the sunset super early this time of year. And, you know, it wasn't, I don't think it was dusk yet, but, like, it was approaching, and I felt like there was less time to figure out this situation. And so she was like, well, I can go drive up there for you. And I was like, okay, because she didn't want to take me, because she didn't want, to feel unsafe. And I was like, okay. She was like, well, I was like, do you have time? Like, I'm so sorry. And she was like, I can drive up there and tell someone where you are. And I was like, okay, great. And so I was like, oh, thank God. Like, I felt like something was happening. I was one step closer to solving the situation. And so I sat on the side of the road, as people passed me by, and just tried to look intimidating so no one would bother me, and just hoped and prayed that this woman was doing what she said she was going to do and was going to help me. And this entire time I'm waiting, the sun is setting, and I'm getting increasingly more worried. I updated my friend and I said, hey, someone's going contact a ranger for me. Things should happen. You know, I'll keep you posted. And also, all the while, my service is going in and out, and my phone is dying. I am also keeping her updated on the percentage that I have, and I'm sure that's stressing her out even more. But I keep turning my phone to airplane mode to save battery, and then turning it back on to see if she texted me or to update her, and then turning it back off. Because I'm sure, as a lot of you know, the roaming, trying to find service, drains your battery. So that also added another layer of stress, because that was one of my only lifelines in this moment. So maybe 30 to 45 minutes go by, and this woman who stopped earlier, her car came back to where I was, and maybe about 100 yards up the road, she pulls off, stops, and throws something out the window, and then keeps driving. And she stops the same distance that she did the first time from me, which is like maybe 15 feet away, rolled down her window and yelled to me. She was like, hey, I told someone, I found someone at the state park. I told them where you were. I told them you were at mile marker 47. And I was like, oh, okay. And started looking around, like, where's mile marker 47? She was like, it's up the road right there. Like, that's the closest one you are to. And I was like, okay, cool. She was like, they said they were going to be sending somebody. And I was like, oh, thank you so much. Like, thank you. And like, just so, so thankful. And she goes, the sun's about to set, but I just dropped off a lantern and some water for you. And I was like, oh my gosh, like, thank you so much. And she was like, are you hungry? And knowing that I was, I said, no. And she was like, are you sure? And I was like, this woman has done so much for me already. She's obviously terrified, and help is on the way. Like, I don't need to eat. It's fine. I was like, no, thank you. Like, I really appreciate it. And she was like, okay, thanks. So I walked up the road, picked up this grocery bag with this like giant thing of water and this little tiny lantern. And in that moment, I was like, the kindness of strangers, like, that is so sweet. Because like, I had my little headlamp, but you know, if I didn't, I would need some sort of lantern. It would be very dangerous for me to be sitting in the dark. So I stay put. I update my friend, hey, you know, they brought me a lantern and water. There's a ranger on their way to come and help me. You know, the situation should be solved very soon. Like, thanks so much for your help. Like, this is not an emergency, you know, whatever. And she was like, well, as soon as it does turn into an emergency, you let me know, because, like, I'm ready to call the cops, like, where you are, in Alabama. And I was like, no need to do that. Like, it is fine. So I proceed to wait on the side of the road with my little lantern, drinking some water. I'd put on my flannel at this point because it had started getting cold because the sun was setting, and then the sun completely set and it was dusk and dark, and I was on the side of the road with a lantern, a headlamp, and a bottle of water, and things started to get scary. I was like, when are the rangers coming? And at this point I'd been waiting for the rangers over an hour. This whole shenanigans, this whole story, this has been hours of my time at this point. So as I'm sitting there on the side of the road, I start to get a little sketched out, and I'm trying to decide what my options are and what I should do at this point. At this point, as far as I know, there's someone on their way to help me, but I've been waiting for over an hour and they're not here yet. I'm asking myself, well, how long does this normally take? Did she talk to the right person? Do they see this as a non-emergency and they're not coming? Am I just waiting for nothing? And then I'm asking myself, should I walk back to the van? And at some point I decide to tell myself that I am going to wait till this time at night. And if no one comes, I'm going to walk back to the van. I'm going to sleep in the van because I can do that. Then I'm going to wake up in the morning with a freshly charged phone and walk back to the main road and try it all over again. Whether that means calling family somewhat in the area or calling the ranger station, calling my friend, something. So I'm sitting there waiting for this, and all the while there had been this family that was up the road that I could hear that was biking, and they had parked maybe 100 yards, 200 yards up the road. And I could only really see them at this point in the night because of, like, their lights. And at this point, there was no cars passing this road anymore. They were the last ones I had seen in over an hour. And so, sort of as, like, a last-ditch effort, I turned my head towards the van because it sounded like they had just gotten back to their van from going on a bike ride, I guess, which was very confusing because who goes on a bike ride at night? But I turned my head towards them and I turned my headlamp off and on a few times in hopes that they'll see me and wonder what the flashing light is. And that was sort of like a last ditch effort because I was too far from them to really yell, and there's no way they would have seen me or known what direction I was coming from. So some time goes by, maybe 5 minutes, and this white minivan pulls up next to me, and they stop and they ask, "Are you okay? What's going on?" And I was like, "Hey," and if you've ever been in situations like this, like, at some point you kind of lose hope that people are going to help you. And it's this minivan filled with people. There's a woman driving and a man in the passenger seat. He rolls down his window and he said, "Hey, you know, what are you doing? And are you okay?" And I was like, "Yeah, I'm fine. I'm waiting for a ranger right now because I got my van stuck up the road and they're supposed to be coming, but I've been waiting for a really long time and it's getting dark. So I think I'm about to just walk back to the van." And they were like, so concerned for me, and this woman and man with their, like, mom and dad eyes looked at me and said, "Do you want a ride?" Because in this moment, I'm surprised that they're not scared of me and that, like, this is a scam. And I was like, "Oh, are you sure? Like, I don't want to make you uncomfortable." And the dad goes, "No, absolutely, get in," and climbs from the driver's seat to the back of the minivan and said, "You can take my seat, get in the passenger." And I was like, "Oh, okay, thank you so much." So I get into the passenger, I look behind me, it's a van filled with a family. There are, like, 2 to 3 kids, grandma in the back, dad in the back, mom in the front, and they're driving me back to the van. Honestly, I felt super grateful at this point that I didn't have to walk back in the dark, because it would have taken me at least 30 minutes to walk back to the van. And we get to chit-chatting, they're asking me where the van is, and what I'm doing here, and all this other stuff, and explaining the situation, and, you know, I thank them profusely, and it takes us a while to get down this dirt road, because they're in a minivan, and they're taking it very safe and slow, which is completely fine, and I'm like, "Yep, it's about 2 miles up this dirt road," and they said, "Oh, okay," so we're driving. And I was like, "Yeah, I got it stuck. I tried to get it unstuck, and I couldn't." And the dad goes, "Well, do you think that we could help you?" And I was like, "Oh, no. Like, that is not your responsibility. Like, don't even worry about it." And he was like, "No, like, it's fine. Like, it's no trouble at all." And I said, "Okay, sure." So we get to the van, finally, and they're like, "Oh, wow, you really got it stuck." And grandma hops in the driver's seat and says, "I'll drive. You guys push." And I was like, "Okay. If you can help me get out of this situation, like, I will accept the help." So grandma drives, we get the oldest son and the dad pushing in the front, we're also pushing in the front, and the van doesn't budge. And I'm like, "Shoot, what are we gonna do? I mean, we have 4 people pushing at this point, like, what's gonna help?" So after we try it a couple more times, with no luck, the dad goes, "We need, like, a better weight distribution. Like, what if you two get in the van and put weight on the back tires?" And I said, "Okay, like, if you think that's gonna work." So me and the mom get into the van, sit on the bed, and grandma is driving in the front seat, and the oldest son and the dad are pushing in the front. and other children are in the minivan. And we get the van unstuck. And I am, like, forever grateful. I thank all of them. Didn't get any of their names. And they asked me where I'm staying that night. And I said, oh, well, that's supposed to be my campsite. But at this point, it had started drizzling and raining. And it was a pretty steep incline. And they go, that's where you're supposed to be staying tonight? And I was like, yeah, but I don't think I'm going to do that. I think I'm going to go find another spot down the road. And they were like, are you sure? Like, we feel terrible leaving you. The mom's like, I almost have half a mind to invite you into our Airbnb. And I was like, oh, no. Like, that is completely unnecessary. Like, thank you, but I will be totally fine. And they were like, okay, like, sounds good. And you could tell in this moment, they, like, didn't understand why I was there alone and, like, just wanted to, like, save me and take care of me. They were very worried for me. But at this point, I'd gotten the van unstuck and, thank God, gotten out of that situation. So I get into my van and I drive back to the main road because at this point my friend still thinks that I am in danger and in an emergency. And so I drive up the road to find service and I call them. And apparently at this point, her and her boyfriend at the time were literally on the phone with the local police at the time that I called them. Explaining the situation, and then I called them to tell them that I was safe and a family had helped me, and they were like, oh, thank God, and I was like, I'm safe, I'm gonna find a place to sleep, like, everything is fine, thank you so much, and they were like, oh, thank goodness, you know, it was just a big, big relief, and I mean, it was late at this point, too, no police needed to be called or come to help me, and, crisis was averted. Though it was very, very scary. And I go and I find a place to sleep, and all is well. A funny part of this story, actually, is the next day I go to drive out of the National Forest, and I stopped at a pull-off that had a really pretty scenic view. And I am in the van in the driver's seat, and there was this man who was also at the pull-off who was creeping me out a little bit, but then he left. I was there by myself. Another person came, and I was like, here we go, someone else to stare at me. And it was this older woman, and she kind of starts walking towards the van, like she's walking towards me. I was very confused and alarmed, and she starts walking towards me like she knows me, and because it's a woman and I'm less threatened, I kind of crack my window, and I go, hello? And she was like, oh my gosh, it is you! And I was like, what? And instantly I recognized her, and she was the grandma from the night before. And I said, oh wow, like, it's so good to see you, like, what a crazy coincidence that we're both here. And she was like, oh my goodness, like, we thought about you all night, it's so good to see that you're safe, you know, we prayed for you last night as a family, and we felt terrible that we never got your name. And I said, me too. I thought about the same thing. Like, I never got you guys' names either. And so she said, if you don't mind, like, what's your name? And I told her my name. And I said, my name's Anne Marie. And she goes, you're joking. You're absolutely joking. She goes, that's the exact same name as my mother. Or something. Someone she was close with in her family. And she just passed away last year. And I was like, oh my gosh, wow, that's insane. And she was like, wow, like, that's crazy. And this woman was a Christian, and, you know, and so we just chit-chatted, and she was just like, wow, like, this is crazy, like, I knew there was a reason for this, and, like, I knew, like, the Lord had a hand in this, and, like, this is just a sign for me. And I was like, wow, like, that's insane, like, I love that, like, good for you. And, you know, I asked her, like, what she's doing with her life, and we were just talking about our lives. She told me, like, what she needed prayers for in that time in her life, and she gave me pepper spray because she was very worried about my safety, and though I felt like I didn't need it, I took it just to make her feel better, and, you know, we both went on our way. But it was just an insane story and a very big coincidence, and I'm very glad that I'm alive today and safe. Some people might say that this story really isn't that big of a deal and I wasn't really in that much danger, which relatively can be accurate. And some people may think that this is the wildest and most insane, scary story of all time. I guess it just depends where you come from, what your perspective is. But that is the story of how I was almost a missing person. It was crazy, and like I said, I'm so glad to live to tell the tale, and that what could have been a very scary and potentially very dangerous situation ended up getting resolved, and things are good. Like I said previously, I've definitely learned from this situation, so hope all of you guys are having an amazing week, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.